Recorded Books and RB Digital present Bound in Blood by P.C. Hodgell. Narrated by Jennifer O'Donnell. Prologue. A Flight of Jewel Jaws. Summer 115. 3 days out from Tentir, the Randon College, they found the first body. The jewel jaws led them to it in a fluttering cloud, changing color against each surface that they passed. Tawny for the bark of a late summer birch, gold for its leaves, stormy blue for a thickening sky. When they landed on the back of the cadet's forage coat, however, they crinkled their wings in disappointment and turned the dusky brown of a bruised plum. The slighter of the two cadets chased them off with her gloved hands and turned over the body. Her companion caught his breath.
Lady, what happened to him?
I don't know. He's Randir anyway. Look at how his token scarf is tied. They stared down at a face that should have been young, but that had sunken in on itself under parched and browning skin. A faint crackle came from his chest, as if something small and tired shivered there. He was breathing. Then, horribly, his eyelids stirred and opened. The eyes themselves were almost opaque, without pupils, but they moved as the irises shifted, searching. Lips creaked open, splitting bloodless at the corners. In a swift movement, the Randon known to the hillmen as Mayor Conti was there, kneeling beside the boy. He drew a white hilted knife, opened the coat, and gently slid the blade home between prominent ribs. The boy sighed and closed his eyes. The cadet, Gari, frowned down at him.
Isn't he one of the cadets who tried to assassinate Ran?
Careful, said Jame. We aren't that far from Wilden. Yes, I think so. For the life of me, though, I can't remember his name.
But the Commandant gave them all permission to leave.
This is unfair, Gari's tone said, in bewildered outrage. How could it have been allowed to happen? He was very young. It did seem hard that the boy should have to confront another of death's uglier faces so soon after his swarm of bees had plunged, stinging, down the Randir tempter's throat. Gari hadn't told them to do that. They just had, answering his vengeful mood, aided by Jame, who at the time had been forcing the woman's mouth open with her thumbs jammed deep into the hinges of the other's jaws.
The Commandant even said that they could come back next year if their lord permitted.
Gari added, still protesting. That's just it. It was their true lord whom they tried to kill. Jame glanced at the hooded Randon who was hacking branches off a sapling. This close to his home keep, she tried to think of the Randir Lordan solely by his hill name, Mayor Conti. For years, he had avoided the shadow assassins sent by the false lord's mother, Ronith, Witch of Wilden, so long that he had almost forgotten the habit of human speech. White skin, white hair, eyes that could hardly bear sunlight. If he hadn't been so obviously a Shanir, one of the old blood, Ronith's scheme never would have worked. As it was, his people turned to him by instinct, as this poor boy just had, unless they were personally bound to the witch or to her son. Then she saw what the Randon was doing and went to help. Soon they had a pole sled lashed with boughs, attached to Mira's saddle. The green-eyed mare took this as placidly as she did most things, including her master's need for a diet of fresh blood and his penchant for painting her pale gray hide all the hues of the current season. When they lifted the cadet, he seemed a mere husk, all but weightless, and he cast no shadow. They spent the rest of that day, and the next, searching for those others of Merconti's house who had tried to kill him in Tentir's subterranean stable. All were mere shells. Some, like the first, were still alive, barely. To these he also brought the white knife, an honorable death at the hands of their rightful lord. Then, on the night of the fifth day, they descended to the silver and crossed into Wilden's grim shadow. Like all the Riverland fortresses, Wilden was built around the fragments of an ancient hill fort. However, unlike Gothragor, where the stones form the foundation of the Death Banner Hall, Wilden's ruins stood on their own, crowning a small hillock in a courtyard near the front gate. That night, a pyre had been laid on the sweet, late summer grass within the ring of stones, and on it rested the bodies of those expelled cadets who had lived long enough to reach home. Kendar stood around them, silent, bearing torches whose flames shifted uneasily in the sulfurous currents that flowed down the steep streets from the witch's tower set high above. There, at a lit window, the Randir matriarch Ronith kept watch. So she and they might all have stood, waiting, since the first word of the failed assassination had reached Wilden days before. Ronith meant to teach her people a lesson, Jame thought. Perhaps they wished her to learn one as well. Careful hands lifted the husks from the sled and placed them beside their fellows. A priest stepped forward and spoke the pyrrhic rune. The night blazed up as if the very air were tinder. A long sigh rose from the watchers. Fire lent a tinge of color to Merconti's pale, impassive face, and to the white hair within the shadow of his travel-stained hood. There was a disturbance on the other side of the flames. Ronith's son, Kennan, Lord Randir, shoved his way through the crowd, glancing across the pyre at the Randon known as Merconti, who was also the exiled Randir heir, Randorok. Kennan wore full Rysar armor with gilded inserts. He glittered red gold in the firelight, a lordly sight meant to overawe. But hate twisted his handsome face into something ugly, something unnatural, something, somehow, almost familiar, Jame thought. His lips writhed. If he gave orders, either no one heard them over the fire's roar, or perhaps understood. Certainly no one moved when he and his mother's sworn followers tried to force their way through the silent onlookers to get at the rival who had eluded them for so long. Randorok watched them struggle against the passive resistance of his house, then turned and left, unspeaking, unhindered. Muffled in their forage hoods, trying their best to be invisible, the two cadets slipped out on his heels. Chapter 1. Naming the Dead. Autumn's Eve, Summer 120. The night wind keened down the stairwells, tasting of rain, and the tapestries that rustled against the cold stone walls of the old keep's lower hall exhaled their stale breath in fitful answering puffs. Woven faces shifted uneasily in the flickering torchlight, a thin lip twisting here, a brow furrowing there. Eyes, so many watchful eyes, most the silver gray of their house. Even if the subject of the banner had had the ill fortune to die wearing the wrong shade, Kendar artisans had somehow blended strands to achieve it. Their work, as usual, was unnervingly effective. From the rags of the dead, teased apart thread by thread, they had created an illusion of life that whispered back and forth, each to each. He can. He can't. He can. He can't. Torisen, Blacklord, paced under the disapproving gaze of his ancestors, scanning their ranks with something like despair. Except for his haggard expression, the fine bones of his face matched the best of those that glared back at him. Moreover, he had donned his least shabby dress coat to honor this occasion and moved within it like a cat within its skin, unconsciously lithe. If it was a bit loose at the waist, well, it had been a hard summer, and only his servant Burr saw him naked to remark on the growing shadows between his ribs.
Winter is coming, he thought with an involuntary shiver. And the greater harvest has failed. How will I feed my people?
But these two were of his house. Never mind that all had died long before he had been born, and might almost be said to have lived in a different world, before the long years of chaos following Ganth Greylord's fall. Twice since he had become High Lord of the Kensarath, and, incidentally, Lord Knorth, Torisen had recited their names on Autumn's Eve to keep their memory alive within their house. True, he'd had help from senior Kendar like Harn Griphard, contemporaries of his father Ganth, and from his former mentor, Adric, Lord Ardith. Even so, there had been gaps, fading features, to whom no one alive could put a name, and others blurred beyond recognition. Weeping Stone and Silent Sentries had not been kind to Warp and Weft, especially when they were no longer bound to a name. Then, too, Harn had told him what little he knew about the disastrous fire here. The night that Torisen's grandfather, Geraint Highlord, had died, with its oddly selective destruction of banners. And the previous spring, his sister Jame had somehow blown out the great stained glass map in the council chamber two stories above, causing most of what banners were left to be sucked up into the night. What he faced now were the survivors of those two catastrophes. Otherwise, they would have felt it the walls a foot or more thick, the oldest moldering together all the way back to the Kensarath's arrival on Rathillion some 3 millennia ago. Still, how many there were? Faces without names. Names without faces. Traditional Kensar believed in well-trained memories rather than in the written word. Hence, to Torisen's knowledge, there was no other record of his house unless fragments of it found their way into story and song. The Master of Knorth, High Lord of the Kensarath, a proud man was he. Power he had, and knowledge, deeper than the Sea of Stars. But he feared death. No one ever would forget Geraldin and his sister consort, Jemethiel Dreamweaver, or the deal that he had wrought with Paramil Darkling to gain his precious, if seer, immortality. Strange to think that, if the songs were true, he still lurked on the other side of the barrier. On the last of 100 fallen worlds, in his monstrous house, chewing the bitter, deathless rind of his life, waiting for what? No one knew. Maybe for the coming of the Tyradan, those three Kensar who were each to embody one of their gods' faces, creation, preservation, and destruction. Few, however, still had hope of that manifestation, especially with the High Lord's house nearly extinct. No, their god had forsaken them almost at the moment of drawing the three people together, and giving them their hopeless task of fighting the shadows.
We are on our own here, Torisen said to the watching faces.
Odd how some also seemed to listen and respond with subtle,
rueful shifts of expression as light from the torch that he carried touched their faces. Kendar's work was indeed marvelous, or the lack of sleep was at last catching up with him. It's been so long since the shadows last menaced us, and without that threat to unite us, we are floundering, falling apart. He felt as if he was, at least. Some said that the honor of his house had fallen with Jaredan, leaving those who fled across the barrier to this new world without true authority. Yet the North had continued to rule, until Ganth Greylord had run mad after the massacre of his family's womenfolk, created even more slaughter in the White Hills trying to avenge them, at last casting down his title and going into exile in the Haunted Lands. There, his twin children had been born. There, he had cast out his daughter, Jame, when she had proved to be Shanir, one of the Old Blood, whom he loathed above all things. There, in his growing madness, he would eventually have killed his son if Torisen hadn't gained the garrison's approval to flee. But did that truly supersede the authority of one's lord and father? If Jaredan had polluted North honor, and Ganth had nearly destroyed what was left of his house, how could his son inherit anything?
"You can't,"
jeered his father's hoarse, all too familiar voice behind the locked door in the Haunted Lands keep where Torisen had grown up, which was still his soul image.
"As High Lord, you swore to protect the people of this house, alive or dead, and you can't even remember their names."
Torisen ran a distraught, scarred hand through black hair, prematurely touched with white. Things had been so much easier when he had commanded the Southern Host, responsible only for the bodies and not the souls of those put in his charge. A year ago, Autumn's Eve had only been a chore. He had meant his presence here tonight, unassisted, to reassure his people. Why couldn't he remember any names now? Or rather, only one. Mullen's honest Kendar face regarded him anxiously from among the ranks of the haughty, high-born dead. He had been one of those who returned, North Kendar, who would have followed their lord into exile, but had been driven back by Ganth in the high passes of the Ebonbane. In despair, some had chosen the White Knife. Others, like Mullen, had become Yondrigon, wretched hangers-on in others' houses, until the unexpected, well-nigh miraculous return of their lord's son. Torisen had reclaimed and bound as many of them as he could, perhaps too many to hold them all. Mullen had earned his place in this hall by practically flaying himself alive on the cold stone floor, all so that his lord would never forget his name again.
"So much blood,"
Torisen murmured, remembering. A lake of it, an ocean, warm at its heart, congealing at the edges. Mullen had been all day at his grisly task, and he, Torisen, had sensed none of that slow agony until the end. The flagstones were scrubbed clean now, but Mullen's blood must have seeped down through the cracks to the keep's very foundation. "The entire Kensereth feeds on Kendar blood," thought Torisen, not for the first time. "We so-called highborn live on it. Was that, too, our god's will? If so, what kind of monster do we serve? And in that service, what kind of monsters have we become? Small wonder that this world hates us, as we so often do ourselves." No names of the living had slipped out of Torisen's memory since Mullen. But by their anxious faces, he knew that they feared it was only a matter of time. Was he truly losing his grip on the living as well as on the dead?
What songs do you think they will sing of me?
He asked the wolver pup Ice, crouched just inside the door, regarding him with her cold, blue eyes.
Torisen Blacklord. A fool was he. Knowledge he had, enough to fill a thimble. And he feared.
Ice had begun to growl softly, stopping him. She didn't like the Death Banner Hall, perhaps because it reeked of old blood and ancient despair.
You didn't have to follow me in here, you know,
he told her. But she followed him everywhere, usually just out of reach, a small white shadow on huge paws that promised unnerving size as she grew. And, like all her kind, she would soon be capable of assuming an at least half-human form. Why a feral orphan of the deep weald should have attached herself to him, Torisen couldn't guess, unless she sensed that he was an outsider here too, like her.
He can't.
He can.
He can't.
Trinity, what a nightmare. As bad as the ones he had once stayed awake days, even weeks to avoid. Somehow, he had recently lost the dubious comfort of knowing when such a dream was coming. Certainly nothing had warned him 9 days ago of what sleep that night would bring. Wrong. His sister Jame had told him, in the Earthwife's lodge, while outside, dueling wind and volcanic ash had flayed the harvest fields. Something terrible happened to our father when he was a cadet at Tentir, at the hands of his brother, Greshon. In sleep, in dreams, something keeps shoving me into our uncle's foul skin, and you into our father's, to show us, to make us see. Well, he hadn't wanted to see then, or to remember now. But splinters of memory stuck in his mind like broken glass. The Lordan's quarters at Tentir. Greshon in his gorgeous, filthy coat, lolling drunk on the hearth, greedily watching. Hands gripping his arms, and the cold kiss of steel as the knife cut away his clothes. A silken voice murmuring in one ear, a mumble in the other. Obscene point and counterpoint.
Little boys should do as they're told. You're weak, and you know it. Your people trust you, and you fail them. How many more will slip through your fingers?
The voices had spoken both to the boy that his father had been, and to him as he was now, but somehow lacking. Somehow maimed.
Cursed be, and cast out, blood and bone, you are no son of mine.
Then had come his sister's voice, in a purr husky with the old blood that ran strong in her veins, sending a chill down his spine.
You will not hurt my brother.
He had barely slept since. A faint sound made Torisen turn sharply, his free hand leaping up to touch the hilts of the throwing knives concealed in the stiff collar of his dress coat. Finally, he'd had time to have new ones forged after worm's venom had eaten away the old the previous winter.
Who's there?
A trim, gray-clad figure detached itself from the shadows. For a moment, Torisen thought that one of the dead had lost patience and was coming for him. But this specter had no face. Then he saw that it was merely veiled. And under that, masked.
Your pardon, High Lord.
The voice was low and soothing, as one might speak to a startled child.
I came to honor an old friend and lost track of the time.
He knew her now, with her tight-laced, dove-gray gown and eyeless mask
for she had been blind since adolescence, and he saluted her warily. Adarina, the Ardith matriarch, glided forward. As with all proper highborn ladies, she wore a full outer skirt over a tight undergarment, which restricted her steps to a flowing mince. Highborn often lived a century and a half, unless violence cut short their lives. Toward the end, many plunged into senility. At 120-odd years, however, Adarina remained as sharp and full of schemes to advance her house as ever. As she passed them, some woven faces stood out more clearly than others and seemed to watch her pass. A tiny white-haired woman with keen, worried eyes. Mullen again. Then a girl disturbingly like his sister Jame, but with softer features and a thin red line across her throat to indicate where Bashtiri's shadow assassins had cut it. However, Adarina paused, the image of demure, elderly innocence. It did occur to me that, in the absence of my kinsman Ardith, you might welcome a little, company tonight. Torisen felt the wolver pup brush against his leg and reached down without looking to restrain her. By reflex, she snapped at his hand, but her teeth only brushed his skin. Jame had told her never to bite either one of them. And in that, if in nothing else, the pup obeyed. Still, she continued to vibrate with menace in his grip as she leaned toward the Ardith. Her instincts, at least, were good. Damnation. Why hadn't he thought to set a guard at the door? Matriarch, the last time you tried to help me, you slipped an aphrodisiac into my wine. The results, I suspect, were not exactly what you had in mind. Not unless she had expected half the women's halls to throw themselves at him, or he, on escaping, to be vilely sick behind a bush. Even now, he couldn't enter the forecourt without highborn girls crowding the classroom windows above to moon over him. In that context, Kinaron's young daughter, Lyra Lackwit, was a welcome diversion as she waved furiously and shouted guileless greetings until one teacher or another dragged her back out of sight. There, too, his sister Jame had certainly left her mark. The women's halls were not likely anytime soon to forget her forced sojourn with them the previous winter. Adarina had the grace to look abashed, as much as one could tell behind the double cover of mask and veil. Then she brushed aside the incident of the drugged wine with an elegant wave of one small hand. As I explained at the time, I hope to clarify your mind. You have been somewhat, distracted since the return of your sister. Such a surprise, of course, to us all, when we thought the North ladies dead. And a cause for ruthless competition, Torisen thought sourly. One more pure-blooded highborn in the North stable, which now consisted of two. It was a pity that one couldn't count the North bastard Kindrie, Shaneer that he was. So, for that matter, was Jame, but that mattered far less than the healer's illegitimacy. Trust his former consort, Kallistein, to have made that public knowledge. Many of the matriarchs were hot for any match that would give their houses a legitimate half-North heir to the High Lord's seat on his death. He almost regretted putting his sister temporarily out of their reach by making her his heir and sending her to the Randon College at Tentir for military training. Anyone who dared to slip her a love potion was apt to get his face ripped off. Ah, Jame, at least I've placed you beyond harm. Tentir protects its own, I hope, It should at least keep ravening suitors from your door.
Not that he had really expected her to make it this far. The Randon College was fiercely competitive, and his sister had been tossed in among the best Kensar of their generation. Mostly Kendar, but also a few highborn, such as the Caineron Lordan, Gorbel, and the Ardith, Timon. Jame, however, was the only highborn female. He suspected that she knew how to fight, but knew little about her other talents, except that, however apologetically, she left a trail of destruction wherever she went. What else besides the Cenothar she might have learned in their years apart, he hardly dared to think. Reports of her progress, or lack thereof, at Tentir had been oddly garbled, as if Harn hadn't quite known what to say. Jame often had that effect on people. First, it had seemed sure that she would fail the Autumn Cull. However, according to Harn's last message, she had somehow passed after all, by redeeming the shame of Tentir. Torisen had no idea what that last meant, but it sounded ominous. What had his sister been up to, besides turning the college upside down, running afoul of a rogue Wrathorn, and nearly getting herself killed? Meanwhile, Adaraina continued to drift around the hall, obliging him to turn with her.
You know, my dear, your estrangement from my lord Adric is most unfortunate and, if you will forgive me, ill-advised. Without his help, you would never have survived to claim the High Lord's seat. A nameless boy, arriving out of nowhere. Who else would have believed you and promoted you to command of the Southern Host, much less stood behind you when you came of age? I had some small part in that. It is my gift, you know, to sense bloodlines by touch, and sometimes degrees of kinship.
Trinity, thought Torisen, with a sick jolt, remembering. Last spring, he had invaded the Matriarch's Council to demand what it had done with his sister. Adaraina had had a cloth stained with James' blood from her slashed face, and he had left drops of his own blood on the floor from a reopened cut on his hand. On her knees, touching them both, Adaraina had cried, "Twins! You are twins after all." No one had brought up that dangerous matter since, the idea being, on the face of it, absurd, and the implications profound. But Adaraina moved on smoothly. Her warning, if such it was, delivered.
We both only want what is best for you and our people as a whole.
She and Adric probably believed that. Moreover, Torisen had sworn never to hurt his former mentor, to whom, truly, he owed much. But to allow the High Lord of the Kensarath to become an Ardith puppet, he'd had enough of that and more as commander of the Southern Host.
Forgive me for mentioning it, but this winter, you will need help. Why the storm should have ravaged your fields worse than anyone else's, no one knows. But surely all your crops except the hay are lost, and winter is coming.
For that tone of sweet reason, he could have strangled her. She thought she had him at last, and perhaps she did. Torisen hardly knew whether to welcome the distraction or to tear his hair out when the door to the outer ward began to scrape open, as if pried by gusts of wind and rain. Sodden leaves scuttled across the stone floor. Nearby death banners flapped in protest while the torch in his hand flared wildly. Then, through the widening crack, slipped a big cat. No, a hunting ounce, anxious to escape the wet. But what followed him?
Torisen had the fleeting impression of a wraith-like figure clothed in storm-torn rags, white hair, and a cloud of steam rising like smoke off an overheated horse. One dark, liquid eye regarded him nervously askance as the creature slipped sideways along the wall. A raised hand covered the other half of that strange, triangular face. Wary ears pricked through its tangled mane. "I'm dreaming," he thought, with a touch of panic. Too many near sleepless nights must have caught up with him, again. Certainly awake, he had never seen such a thing. And he wasn't sure that he was seeing it now. Then his attention snapped back to the door, as a third person entered it, clad in a cadet's field jacket with the hood up against the weather. Ah, of course. He crossed the room in quick strides to grasp the newcomer by the shoulder. The hood fell back, and a coil of long black hair tumbled over his hand. He saw the quick flash of extended ivory claws, instantly sheathed, for he had startled her.
"What are you doing here?" he demanded.
"Hello to you too."
His sister Jame gave him her usual wry smile, tilted further askew by the thin, straight scar that ran around one high cheekbone. His former consort, the Caneron Kallistein, had given her that, while he had kept to the southern wastes to avoid them both. It was a year since Jame had returned, but every time he saw her, the difference in their ages shocked him. How had his twin come to be a good decade younger than he was? There was still so much he hadn't asked her, afraid of the answers he might get.
"What have you done with your hair?"
he blurted out. Except for the fallen coil, the rest was looped up in an ornate construction secured by... what? Something alive and moving.
"I've been on the road with someone who likes to play with it."
She waved a gloved hand around her head.
"Shoo!"
Multiple feet let loose. Black wings unfolded and took flight as the rest of her hair tumbled down in a tangled ebon sheet to below her waist.
"The Randon wants me to cut it, but be damned if I will. It's the only good feature I've ever had."
"Jewel jaws?"
He stared at the carrion-eating butterflies settled on a nearby banner, changing color as they did so to match the weave and distort the features that they mimicked. Jame slipped off her jacket and flapped it at them.
"I said shoo! Do you want to get left behind?"
Wings rose in a swirling cloud and fluttered reluctantly out the door, leaving the banner pocked with tiny holes where old blood had spotted it.
"They're a species called crown jewels," she explained, "migrating south with their master, who should be well on his way by now. And no, jaws notwithstanding, he isn't dead, unlike some of our mutual acquaintances."
Movement caught his eye. The blind ounce Joran was stalking the wolver pup Ice, or perhaps vice versa, around Adarina's full skirt and rigid form.
"Harn didn't tell you that I was coming, did he?"
"He did not. Again, why are you here?"
A roil of emotions, alarm, fear, hope, surprised him. He had almost decided what to do with his sister if, when, Tentir cast her out.
"Did you fail the call after all?"
"Oddly enough, no. When I left, at a dead run, mind you, the Randon Council seemed to be having a collective fit. At least Harn was jumping up and down in the map room, about to smash through the floor."
She laughed.
"The Commandant keeps asking me not to drive my instructors mad, So far, I've only done it to one of them, and then helped to kill her. A Randir tempter. Laughter died, and her expression hardened, eyes glinting silver. She deserved it.
I don't think I would want you for an enemy, Torisen heard himself say.
Ah. She raised a hand to touch his cheek, but stopped herself as he flinched away from her fingertips, sheathed as they now were. That I will never be.
Adarina's voice broke in on them, sharp with outrage.
Have you dared to bring a horse into this sacred place? Tonight of all nights? Don't deny it. I smell its sweat.
For that matter, said Jame, as the ounce nosed around the Ardith's skirts, more interested in the wolver pup lurking behind them than in the highborn herself.
I smell yours.
Your pardon, Matriarch. I didn't expect to find you here. They say in the women's halls that you never attend your own Autumn's Eve memorials at Omaroth. So why ours tonight?
Anyway, not a horse. A winnow here.
The pale figure had stopped before a banner, that of the tiny white-haired woman. It seemed to Torisen that they leaned into each other, embracing. But surely that was a trick of the flickering light. Jame crossed over to them, then hesitated, uncharacteristically deferential. The old woman reached out to draw her in, then placed the other's hands in her own gloved ones.
Let the living go with life.
You're sure, Matriarch? James' voice trembled slightly.
So far, few things have proved safe in my keeping, let alone something so precious.
My trust in you, great-granddaughter. I am dreaming, thought Torisen, and gave his head a thump with the heel of his hand. That, or worse.
Jame wrapped her jacket around those slim, steaming shoulders.
The horsemaster at Tentir would never forgive me if you caught a chill, lady.
9 days on the road, she added aside to her brother. But the first few between Tentir and Wilden, there were problems. We had to gallop the last bit to make it on time, if barely that. Moreover, Belle is recovering from a bowed tendon. But where are my manners? Torisen Blacklord, may I present Belle Terry, the White Lady, formerly known as the Shame of Tentir, through no fault of her own.
Adarina stiffened, at which the pup charged the ounce, and both streaked up the northeast stairwell in a wild scramble of claws.
Impossible. Belle Terry was Kinsey's mount, dead these 40 years.
Not dead, wounded, and hiding in the Earthwife's lodge. Our Uncle Greshon put a branding iron to her face, all to spite great-grandmother Kinsey.
Do you know why, Matriarch?
The old highborn bristled.
Who could understand such an atrocity? Dear Kinsey and her grandson Greshon quarreled. Such things happen.
Huh. Like the massacre of the North Ladies?
Jame paused, as if listening.
Belle, you had better rejoin our boy. He's getting restless and upset.
Our boy?
Torisen asked, as Belle Terry slipped past him out the door, shedding the jacket as she went.
Someone I hope you will meet. Someday. If we don't kill each other first.
As she scooped up the fallen coat and slipped into it, hoofbeats rang outside, their retreating sound quickly swallowed by the boisterous wind.
I didn't know that the winnow here were shapeshifters, said Torisen,
at a loss for anything else to say. Neither did I, at first. They don't do it often. It does make one wonder, though, about Lord Ardith's long relationship with Brithany, Bell's sister. Adaraina took a hasty stride forward, brought up short by her tight underskirt.
Wretched girl! You dare!
I dare many things, lady, said Jame in a level tone. As well you know. Sometimes right, other times wrong. But I'm good, eventually, at finding out the truth.
Yes, by breaking things.
If necessary. The Ardith drew herself up.
You are a disgrace to your race and sex.
Torisen stepped between them.
Stop it. This is a night to honor the dead, not to create more by starting new blood feuds.
The Ardith laughed.
Yes. Honor them, if you can remember their names.
Jame had been scanning the attentive ranks. I can tell you one problem right now. These banners have been rearranged. Both twins turned to give the blind matriarch a hard look. She couldn't have done it herself, Torisen thought, but she might easily have had help. Another piece of Ardith trickery, more subtle than drugged wine, but then that had been a hasty improvisation, taking advantage of his unexpected return to Gothragor. He was growing very tired indeed of the women's world infesting his halls.
I know some of the names, said Jame, her attention returning to the banners. The North Kendar at Tentir have been teaching me. That's why Harden sent me, I think.
She stopped before Mullen's banner. But who is this? Torisen told her. He came to me in a dream, she said, distressed, and asked me to remember him. But I couldn't. We had never met. She touched the banner gingerly. These woven strips of leather. Is this his actual skin tanned? Torisen had never asked or noticed, which shook him.
The Kendar took his body. They have their own customs.
She moved on to the white-haired woman. And this, of course, is our great-grandmother, Kinsey Keen-Eyed, the last North matriarch. Your special friend, Ardith. These, I'm not sure. Our grandfather, Geraint Highlord, and his consort, Talarian?
Token banners, said Adaraina behind them.
Talarian's was consumed in the fire here, the night that Geraint died, and his son Ganth became Highlord, to the eventual grief of us all.
The same flames consumed both Geraint and Greshon's bodies, the latter none too soon. He had been 5 days dead at the time.
For a moment, Torisen almost thought he saw them. His father facing his grandfather over a bloated corpse, clad in gilded leather, lying on a pall-draped catafalque. Lips moved. They were arguing. Behind them, avidly listening, stood a slim, veiled lady in black, with stars spangling her skirt. And behind her, a man dressed as a servant, but with a most peculiar expression. In a blink, they were gone. Jame's breath caught. Had she also seen that brief, strange apparition? She turned away, looking puzzled, and started again.
Now what? He demanded irritably.
Nothing. I thought I saw banners falling, there, along the eastern wall. No,
being ripped down. And behind them, what?
Torisen stared at the wall in question. By tradition, the oldest banners hung there, dating back to the fall. But again, fire and rot had destroyed many, while someone more recently had scrambled the rest. Several hung crookedly. One slipped sideways even as he watched, and slumped to the floor. The sight shook him, more than he would have believed possible. Worse was the sudden exposure of the keep's wall beyond. Greshon's pyre had seared it and laced some of the ancient stones with cracks. One had actually exploded as the air pockets in it expanded, the very foundation of his house undermined, breached.
"I told you,"
whispered his father's voice from the depths of his soul.
"As my father told me, a dying, failed house we have been ever since Jaredin betrayed us to the shadows."
Torisen stared at the ragged hole where the stone had been, which the banner had masked. Over ages, either the hall had sunk or the ground had risen, probably both, to conceal this damage from the outside. A cold wind breathed out of the dark gap as if out of a toothless mouth. Stinking of earth and death and hunger. If he stared long enough, what would he see?
"Nothing," said Torisen harshly. "Nonsense."
And he went to rehang the fallen tapestry. It was ancient, the survivor of fire and neglect, but only through the tightness of its weave. Its own weight ripped it apart as he lifted it up.
"Try this."
Jame had come up behind him, gingerly holding the tanned hide of Mullen's banner at arm's length.
"It may be the newest one here, but I think it's also the strongest."
When he raised it to the hook, it neatly filled the gap left by the other's fall, like closing a door against the dark. As he lowered his hands, they brushed against Mullen's woven ones. He could almost feel the latter move, warm and reassuring under his touch.
"Trust me, my lord."
"That's better,"
James said, with a sigh of relief as he stepped back. And so it was,
never mind why.
She looked around the hall again, back to business. "I don't recognize Greshon here, in token or otherwise, which isn't surprising given how Ganth Greylord felt about him, and why. We haven't been fortunate in our uncles, have we?"
Torisen said nothing to that, not knowing what she meant. Besides, she had moved on to another blurred face with strangely anxious eyes.
"Negligent nerves on edge, I think. A third cousin twice removed, dead on his wedding night of a nosebleed. How embarrassing."
Threads once sodden with blood seemed to droop in relief. After that, it became easier to remember names. Other houses, no doubt, had more elaborate rituals to honor this night. Surely Adric did at Omeroth. But here it was only the two of them. Torisen began to relax. How much of his distress had been mere fear of failure? As much as his sister disconcerted him, she had a wry way of taking things in stride that was strangely reassuring. Paws thundered overhead. Ice bounded down the northwest stair, closely pursued. The wolver pup skittered on dank flagstones and was bowled over by the ounce. When Ice wriggled onto her back, Joran pinned her and began furiously to groom her creamy chest.
Jame had stopped in front of the death banner of the mild-faced girl, who in other ways so closely resembled her.
"What's Arielon doing here? The Brandon were supposed to hold her in perpetuity."
At her sharp tone, Ounce and Pup looked up, startled, and Torisen's ease shattered. Only when it was gone did he realize that for the past half hour, he had almost been happy.
"Lord Brandon sent her back when I refused to accept the price demanded for her contract," he said, suddenly on the defensive, although not quite sure why. "Our father asked too much. Besides, the poor girl has been dead these 30 years and more, ever since the massacre. If Brant still loves her so much, hasn't he earned the right to keep her banner without further grief?"
"It doesn't work that way."
Adaraina was suddenly between them.
"I forbid you to speak," she said to Jame, and even Torisen could feel the power behind her words.
She was, after all, not only the Ardeth matriarch, but the leader of the matriarch's council, and her voice, that of the women's world. His sister had gone back a step, but now she stood her ground. On the wall, her fire-cast shadow darkened. Ice fought free of Jorin. The fur along both creatures' spines rose as they backed away.
"You and your precious secrets," Jame said softly. "Are they worth your adopted daughter's sanity?"
"I said, be quiet."
They were circling each other now, with Torisen hastily moving aside.
"I am not bound by your rules, lady. A winter in your care earned me only this."
Jame traced the scar on her cheek with a gloved fingertip.
"Whatever else I learned, I took by right of discovery. Still,"
and here she made an obvious effort to control herself,
"Tori, you made the Brandon a generous offer, declining payment, especially when our house needs funds so badly to survive the winter. But believe me, it wasn't a kindness."
"The Jaren matriarch told me as much just after summer's day."
Even to himself, Torisen sounded petulant. Dealing with the women's world set his teeth on edge. Always there was that unnerving sense of important things left unsaid, of being kept in the dark, out of control.
"Trishian is wise, as well as learned, which isn't always the same thing. Did she add that refusing Arielon's price demeans her in the eyes of someone, anyone who loves her? And that is a deadly insult."
No. The Jaren hadn't gone that far. But he could almost see it, almost understand. Yet to accept that outrageous fee was to sanction his father's greed.
"You want nothing from me, boy, do you? Except my power."
The nightmares he had shared with his sister, the obscene things that had happened to his father as a child, that had shaped him into what he had become. "Perhaps we can learn to understand, if not to forgive him," his sister had said. "Either way, we needn't become either our father or our uncle." But he didn't want to understand, not while there was a locked door in his soul and a mad, muttering voice on the other side. The stairs behind him led up to the cold comfort of his turret room, as far from the rest of Gothregor as he could get without leaving its walls. He touched his inheritance with mere fingertips and with loathing, but he had done the best he could for his people this night.
"I've heard enough," he said. "I'm tired. We've named everyone either of us can remember, and our duty is done. I'm going to bed."
With that, He turned and climbed, taking the light of his torch with him. The wolver pup Ice sat at the foot of the stair until he was out of sight, then ghosted up the steps after him. Chapter 2. A Dance in the Dark. Autumn's Eve, Summer 120, Part 1. In the absolute dark that the High Lord left behind, Jame let out her breath in a long sigh.
Well, do you think so?
Not really. Voice answered voice in the rustling void. Kenser have good night vision, but not without some light.
I am no stranger to the dark, you know, said the blind matriarch. And I have a very good visual memory.
A feline screech, a muffled curse.
You were saying, my dear.
I was apologizing to Jorin for stepping on his paw. And I apologize to you too, lady, if I was rude. But truly, the secrets of the women's world aside, couldn't someone have told my brother enough to make him understand? This second loss of Aerulon is driving Brenweir mad. Sweet Trinity, she's your sisterkin by way of Kinsey and a Shaunir Maladite. Her curses kill. How long do you think she can restrain them?
Brenweir is strong. I taught her to be.
That, Jame had to admit, was true. Most Maladites died young, either by suicide or at the hands, in self-defense, of their own kin. Brenweir believed that she had accidentally killed her own mother. Perhaps she had. Only great self-control had allowed her to survive a torturous childhood and adolescence. However, Jame had been drawn into Brenweir's soul image, where the so-called Iron Matriarch endlessly paced and raged.
Aerulon, sisterkin. You gave me strength and love, and then you died. And now must I lose your banner, too? He tossed you to me, ancestors, damn him, like a bone to a dog. The insult, the shame.
Oh, yes, she is strong, said the matriarch's voice from a different part of the hall.
She was moving about in the freedom of her eternal night, the swish of her gown swallowed by the restless stir of banners in the wind that soughed under the keep's two doors. Before, Jame could have tracked her through Jorin's senses, but the ounce had retreated in a sulk to nurse his sore paw. Something filmy brushed across her face, making her start. A light laugh sounded almost in her ear.
Nervous, girl. Here before your ancestors, in those shameless clothes, with that naked, despoiled face. The last high-born female, I will not say lady, of a house nearly extinct.
That teasing touch again. James snatched and caught a wisp of cloth, Adarina's veil. She almost executed a fire-leaping leg sweep in hopes of tripping the woman, but restrained herself. Cold stone would not be kind to such old bones. Besides, she felt dizzy and oddly breathless, as if all the room's air was bleeding away, even though the draft from under the two doors chilled the clammy sweat breaking out on her face. Dark as it was, images flickered about her, as they had when, for a moment, she had thought she glimpsed Greshon on his bier. Two men arguing over a bloated corpse, a woman watching, a third man in the shadows whose face kept twisting, changing. Surely, I know that woman, thought Jame. Something about her avid eyes and smile before such a terrible sight. Ronith, young and ravenous with ambition. What had she been doing here that night? Then the Randir's gaze had abruptly shifted and caught Jame eye to eye. Her smile had deepened with a hint of sharp, white teeth.
Scapegrace. Spoiled goods. Forget.
She saw me, Jame thought, shaken anew. She was here, both in the past and in the present. She told me to forget her, and until this moment, I had. Her head swam. What had she been trying to remember? Utterina's voice jerked back her attention. Brenweir will be stronger still when she finally lets Eriolan go. To remember the dead. To mourn them, yes. But not to embrace them. Let the living go with life.
You heard that?
Yes.
No.
Now Jame's heart was pounding in her throat, and she thought she saw stars. No, faint constellations of light against the walls across which Adarina's slim, dark form moved like a cloud rack obscuring the night sky. What Jaredin left of your house, Ganth Greylord destroyed, and with it the Kensarath's future as it had been foretold. Sway. Turn. Hand arched just so. Despite her tight underskirt and age, the old highborn was dancing. Her voice wove as if in a dream through her tiny flowing steps, through darkness and spectral light. We floundered, lost, abandoned. You have no idea what a nightmare that was. Honor. Who could define it anymore? The strong learned to prey upon the weak. House on house. Highborn on Kendar. Male on female. Everything was falling apart. Yet not quite. Ganth still lived, though in exile. And then his son, hidden by my lord Ardeth among the southern host. Their mere existence sustained us, or so I believed. Then, finally, Torisen stepped forward to claim his inheritance. And we awoke. Our god had abandoned us, but one of his chosen had returned. A new beginning, we thought. A new direction. Then you appeared, out of nowhere, out of nothing. We tried to make you one of us. The women's world bears the scars of that encounter, even as you do. And now what?
Lady, please.
Shh. The sound slithered around James' throat and began to tighten. She fell to her knees. One part of her mind noted, "This is a wind-blowing technique. I didn't know that the Senatha could be used this way." Another part thought, "If that witch comes near me again, I'm going to break both of her legs." And a third, barely an incredulous whisper. She's killing me.
I could not see how you looked at one another when you first met tonight.
That smooth, soft voice continued.
But I could hear. You cut, so as not to kiss.
Something dripped onto the floor between James' hands, spattering them.
Her nose had started to bleed.
If you were twins, according to the custom of your house, you would already be consorts, and perhaps between you have bred a third of your pure blood. Then finally, the Tyradan might have come to complete our fate. And you are twins, are you not? Despite the difference in your ages. I sensed it when I touched your blood. You are also a nemesis, but not the nemesis. For there is no third to balance you.
As James' blood sank into a crack between the flagstones, lines of pale light spread outward from it, limning the stone's edges. She knelt on the edge of the pool formed when Mullen had shed his life's blood.
I think if you were to become your brother's mate, you would destroy him. I think you may anyway. Then will come chaos far, far worse than anything that has ever happened before. Worse even than the fall. And everything will fall apart. Before that, better that you should die.
Her voice faltered. Looking up, James saw Mullen, or rather a woven patchwork of light, seemingly without a head, for in death, his face had been unmarked. His burly arms circled something slim and dark, without touching it. The Ardeth matriarch stood absolutely still by the eastern wall, within that phantom, restraining embrace.
What is it?
She asked, barely above a whisper.
Who is it?
The guardian of the hall, newly appointed. Trinity, was that croak her voice?
Hello, Mullen.
Joran crept to her side, chirping anxiously. She fended him away from her spilt blood with an elbow, then rose unsteadily, wiping her nose on her sleeve. She could see them all now, those who had died in a welter of their own gore, standing around the edge of the room. Or rather, she could see the dim light emanating from those spots on their death banners, where the blood still clung. They were all watching her. Adarina and I were sisterkin. Kinsey's voice was a thin, red thread weaving through James' mind. Forgive and let go. Huh, said Jame. But she nodded to the Kendar, and he stepped back. The Ardeth matriarch wrapped her thin arms around herself as if to contain her shivering.
What is happening? I don't understand.
Lady, you said that Brenweir should give up Eriolan's banner. Just walk away. Well, she can't. Death isn't that simple. A harsh laugh answered her, a crack to the heart's core.
Child, what do you know of grief or of death?
Less and less, the more I learn, or so it seems. Lady, have you ever touched a death banner?
Once. My mother's. What I saw then, it blinded me. I never saw anything again, except what the blood of the living shows me. Old blood. Cold blood. Dead blood. Abomination. Ancestors be praised that the pyre sets free all souls.
Does it? Lady, think. We burn flesh and bone. But what about blood? Many of these banners are saturated in it. Mullen's? Kinsey's? Eriolan's?
What are you suggesting?
The dead know what concerns the dead.
Kinsey told me that when we met in the Soulscape's moon garden. My unfortunate granddaughter, Thierry, is dead, and so am I. While our blood traps us, we walk the gray land together, two of a silent host. Lady, what else could she mean? And what is the gray land?
Nothing. Nowhere. Do you claim now to be a soul walker, or do dreams stalk you as they do your brother? Mad, the both of you. The dead are at peace. Tell me no more.
James sighed. She was tired of people who didn't ask questions and wouldn't listen to answers. God's claws, she was simply tired. As you wish, lady. By the firefly light of that host of trapped souls, she made her way to the eastern door, opened it, and stepped through with Joran on her heels. Her last glimpse of the interior showed Adarina standing rigidly still, hands over her ears, surrounded by the dead. Part 2. Outside in the forecourt of the women's world, Jame leaned against the closed door of the Death Banner Hall, loosening the collar of her shirt as she waited for her pulse to calm. The last night of summer was warmer than the hall's interior, if more boisterous and fitfully spitting rain. Her clothes already felt drenched with clammy sweat, and the wind swirled her loosened hair up into her face, where strains of it stuck and clung. Had Adarina really meant to kill her? Torisen had warned them not to start a new blood feud by slaughtering each other, but he hadn't seriously thought that they would. Surely Adarina wouldn't have been so foolish, or so desperate. Jame kept forgetting how involved others were in her relationship to the High Lord, and how important various aspects of it were to the Kensarath as a whole. Trinity, as if it wasn't hard enough to sort things out just between the two of them. And what to do about all those other souls caught like flies in the ancient, tattered web of their mortality? Get someone to utter the Pyrrhic rune and spark another indiscriminate holocaust? That surely must have been what happened when Greshon's corpse burned, along with all the other blood-stained banners in the hall at the time. Not everyone would want to go up in flames, though, and risk being forgotten. Certainly not poor Mullen. Take the rest down to the river and beat them on rocks until they were washed clean and stopped whimpering. She would have to ask great-grandmother Kinsey about it. But not tonight, and with no guarantee of getting a helpful answer. The haunt singer Ash had once told her that the dead knew what concerned the dead. Jame's sense, though, was that what concerned the dead didn't necessarily extend to the living whom they had left behind. Moreover, without a strong incentive and a stronger will, she suspected that all souls eventually faded away, like sinking deeper and deeper into the dementia that seized so many highborn in extreme old age. A living death, or death in life. Ugh. No wonder most preferred the clean, quick oblivion of the pyre, so much so that some went to it still alive when they felt their minds failing. Just the same, something had happened in that hall, the night of Greshon's unceremonious pyre. Why had Geraint been ripping banners off the eastern wall? What had been that gaping, breathing darkness behind them, where there should only have been ancient stone, or at worst, innocent earth? But she knew, from experience she would rather not possess. Geraint had allowed Paramul Darkling to breach that chamber. Ancestors only knew why. Rathillion was thin, there by the eastern wall, like parts of the palace at Karkinaroth, like the White Hills, with the shadows pressing hard against a barrier weakened by her own people's refusal to believe that it still existed, and by the apparent reluctance of the four who embodied Rathillion to take the shadows seriously. At the fringes of this world in the haunted lands and the southern wastes, such a threat was understandable. But here, in her family's most sacred place? Sweet Trinity, what had happened to bring that about? And why was she sure that that bastard Greshon was somehow at the root of it? It was Greshon's quarters at Tentir all over again, a room full of bad memories trying to reveal themselves to her in nightmare visions. The last time she had had to drug herself with that vile green liquor, otherwise good for etching stone, to get at the truth. This time, perhaps it would be easier, but not by much. Why couldn't someone from the past simply write her a letter? Dear Jame, sorry for the inconvenience, this is what really happened. Her nose was bleeding again. As she snuffled wetly into her sleeve, a dark figure limped quickly across the forecourt toward her. Rowan, her brother's steward. The North Kendar must have been watching both doors, hoping to catch her on her way out. Glass crunched under the Randon's boot. This must be where the shards of the great stained glass window had fallen when she had summoned the wind and blown it out. Not that she'd had much choice at the time. Shadow assassins had been after her and had already half paralyzed her by their touch. The sudden blast had not only sent banners flying from the hall below, but had ripped free the assassin's shadow-cast souls, killing them with the shock. They had only been boys, apprentices sent for their first blooding on a mission to close an old contract on the North Ladies. They had been told that it would be an easy kill. No one had expected their target to be a Shaunir nemesis. No matter that she was only a few years older than those unfortunate apprentice assassins, in experience, she felt ancient. Darrenby was right, she thought, rubbing her eyes, remembering a friend from what seemed like a different life. To some, I am a baited trap. Lordan, are you injured? At the Randon College, Jame was only a first-year cadet, and Rowan an officer. But here she was also the High Lord's heir. She waved off the Kendar and pinched the bridge of her nose to stop the flow. I'm fine, but keep back. I'm a bloodbinder. Rowan stopped short. Her scarred face never registered emotion, but every line of her lean form turned wary. Do they know that at Tentir? Since the first week, when Briar Ironthorn knocked out one of my front teeth. She released her nose and sniffed cautiously. So far, so good. Luckily, no one touched the blood, and the tooth grew back. Then, if you could spare a few minutes, Lordan, please accompany me to the common room. The garrison would like to meet you. What Rowan meant was that the other North Kendar wanted to be sure that she knew all of their names. Kept sequestered in the women's world during her winter here, she hadn't had the chance to meet many of her brother's people. Now, however, she was his declared heir, and that changed everything. James sighed. She had the highly trained memory of most Kenser, but it already felt stuffed full and groaning at the seams. Still, maybe Mark would be there. How good it would be to see the big Kendar again and to talk over with him his plans to rebuild the keep's stained glass windows. Never mind that he had never tackled such a project before. All his long life as a reluctant warrior, he had only wanted to create. It was kind of Tori to let him try, especially after Mark had refused to accept a formal place in the High Lord's establishment. Waiting for you, lass. As if her brother were ever likely to let her set up an establishment of her own, much less formally bind Kendar to her service, She knew only too well how much he feared the strength of her Shanir blood. Although they were twins, it wasn't even clear which of them had been born first. Not that that mattered in a society that saw its highborn females primarily as breeding stock. Inside the hall at her back, all was quiet. It would be just her luck if Adaraina had dropped dead of a heart attack. On the other hand, if the matriarch started screaming, presumably Torisen would feel obliged to do something about it. All right, she said to Rowan, as she caught her wind-tossed hair, half of it still tangled in fancy braids, and twisted it into a knot. After all, there must be no more forgotten names like poor Mullins. I have something to do first, though. I'll meet you in the garrison within the hour. Sooner, if I can. Gari should already be there, and, I hope, made welcome. Lordan. The steward's voice held all the perturbation that the damaged muscles of her face could not show. You took your time on the road. Word arrived days ago of events at Tentir on the night of the call when the stones were cast. She glanced toward the halls of the Randir women's world, where, even at this hour, some windows showed lights and moving silhouettes. They've clenched in on themselves like a fist over there, especially the Kendar guards, just waiting for someone to hit. Jame tightened the knot with a jerk. If they've heard, then they know that their Shanir tempter earned her death. Grisly as it was. She didn't just try to assassinate a fellow Randon within the college's very walls. She suborned cadets to help her. All paid for it. And she told Rowan about the grim harvest that they had delivered to the pyre at Wilden. We heard something about that, said Rowan, who had been listening in bleak silence. The dead cadets might belong to another house, and one reckoned an enemy by the north, but the loss of any young Kendar was a grief to all. The Danior of Shadow Rock kept watch on Wilden from across the river that night, although they weren't sure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.